place.
When I'm a little stressed out from a final.
Yeah. Who's that? It's the Reverend. I've been called. I've been ordained. I've been called by God. But I got to make me dance. But I got to make me praise Him. I've been ordained.
Cause mommy hit me at the wrong time, telling me you had a short time to get my 95 down the stairs so we can
saved in 84. 10 years later, he says you are mine. Get in the field.
Aimed at the steeple where the people made an unbelievable sound. The keyboards under the sweet organ where the deacons and greeters was meeting the seekers at the door with arms open wide saying, give me some
praise. Give him praise like that. Yeah. Give him praise. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. Give him praise. Sunday morning. Here, New Life Open Doors, KCAA, New Life Open Doors Radio. I'm here live. I'm Robert Newsom. I'm Robert Newsom. R to the E to the B to the E to the C. Who's that? I love him today. I love him today. I love him today. I got to praise him. I got to glorify his name. I got to magnify him for his work there. He's heard their praise. Give God some praise out there. Give God some praise. He woke you up this morning. You didn't die in your sleep last night. Give God some praise. You're able to get up out the bed. We're glorifying. We're glorifying. Yeah. You don't understand. We're ashamed today. Ashamed of the powerful name. I can't be ashamed. Oh, give God some praise. I'm a Reverend EC. Can I say amen? Praise the Lord. I just want to thank the Lord for those that's tuning in. Praise God. We're hoping to be a blessing to you because God have truly been a blessing. God have truly been a blessing to me. Can I say praise Him, praise Him. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. I just want to bless the Lord. My soul cries out, hallelujah. I'm going to say it again. My soul cries out, hallelujah. Amen. If you're out there today, praise the Lord. I don't want you to go through the motion. You see, I live the life. Though I come in here, because I'm dealing with a hostile people. What are you talking about, Reverend? I have to bring love, the love of God. But the task is, praise God, people don't want to hear it. People don't want the true gospel today. Praise God. So you force, oh Lord, they're quick to turn the station. They don't hear you preach. Don't preach to me. Don't tell me how to live. We're in that new age today, Lord. So I have to, my task is to bring the love of Jesus Christ into the station, praise God, and send it out into the airways and the highways and to the byways. Jesus loves you. But there is requirements for all of us. Praise God. I wish I found out that the Lord has the best intent for our lives, and doing it His way is the best way. Praise God. Praise the Lord. I've ran a couple of I hadn't been here. I've been here, but just my schedule been kind of all over the place a little bit. You know, I'm a working man of God. I've always been. Real estate, praise the Lord. I got in real estate, praise God, and God blessed me in that area, though. It has not been easy to get the ching, ching, ching. You don't understand me. What am I talking about? To get the cheese, though. The old young folks said the cheese. They used to say the cheese, the guap, whatever you want to call it, but to us simple lay people, the money. Lord. You don't understand me. In order to keep from ripping people off, doing things to go against the word of God, I had to walk light and do so. Therefore, I didn't make all the money that I could have made because I have integrity. Come on, somebody. I have integrity and pray that my investments would pay off and pray that God would show me favor. But yet I kept the gospel. Yet I held on to the gospel. And, you know, God has been good. And, you know, I love Him today because He have kept me from, you know, we need money out here. Money pays the bills. So sometimes we're willing to turn ahead when it comes to wrong and put God on his principles on the back burner. You know, I got to get this money. Father, you understand, I got to get this money. Well, I couldn't do that. I had a good friend of mine who was a lender. He also was a believer. And praise God. And I would ask him, well, look, you know, as we being Christians, I have a problem with certain things. You know, he said, well, that's just what people do now. You know, you mess up, you have to do it this way. But I had a problem because I've been with Jesus for 10 years and I was trying to walk the walk. Can I say amen? But God has shown me, and I just love him today because I am 56 years old today. Not just today, I'm 56. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All right, brother. And amen. He have kept me. Praise God. And I look, I'm down in the months. I'll be 57 years old. Can I say amen? And not a year from now, but it's months from now. So time is moving so fast. And but I thank God that he have kept me all this time. And he have blessed me in the, you know, I can't give credit to real estate because I told you I just gave a property away maybe in 2012, 2011 for $40,000. I owned it free and clear, but I was tired. I was frustrated. You know, there's nothing easy under the sun. I was tired of dealing with the stress of the people, the tenants, and I just wanted, when you're trying to do this thing alone out here, praise God, just you and the Lord, it can get overwhelming and stressful. So I had to let it go, but I thank God again. My steps were ordered by the Lord, and I have no regrets. I blessed another family, and I pass by it every now and then. Over in the city of Victorville, I cruise by it, but I know it was God's will, so there's no regrets in my life. God turned around and blessed me with another one. I got rid of that, and he turned and blessed me with another one. I own it free and clear. Praise God. So, you know, the thing is this, I'm not your paid preacher, and I don't want people to, the gospel gets a bad reputation by people because they never get to know, come to know this Jesus Christ for themselves. We as pastors or ministers or brothers in the Lord, sisters in the Lord, we represent Christ, and sometimes we don't do a good job. We muddy up the water. We muddy up the water of Jesus Christ, and people say, man, that was a Christian, and man, she beat me just as quick as somebody in the street. There was a young lady did a loan, and she did a reverse mortgage loan, and the loan rep got it for $25,000, and when it all settled down, she wound up losing the property, but when it all settled down, people are looking for that money. That's why the Bible says you can't be a lover of money. Come on, somebody, and love God too. You see, we need money, but money cannot be your God because you'll step on anybody's head to get it. But how many know that young lady who got beat? She beat folks, and she was pretty dirty, and came on back, and she thought she was into something. At the end of the day, she got robbed by her own type. You can I say amen? And so you learn in this thing. Don't let money today, what she got, nothing. Lord, she has nothing. And so, you know, we can think we're on top, but God will bring you down because he sees what each and every one of us do. Praise God. And if it's lining up to his word, you ain't finna make him change his word. You're not finna make him redo what he've already spoken and foretold. Now, we can line up and get on board, but you ain't finna have the God of heaven, the God, all-powerful God. God, we ain't making him do anything. Come on, somebody. Can I say, but now we can do something. We can repent and turn from our sins. Let me say it again. We can repent and try to make it in. Can I say amen? Let me get to the word of God because I've, praise the Lord, I've did everything I could to get here. I feel guilty when I don't, I try to do what God has called me to do. Praise the Lord. And again, but like I said, I'm a working pastor, and I'm a businessman. I'm a man of God first, and then I'm a businessman second. Praise God, because Paul said, I'd rather work with these hands, though I can receive from you all, and I deserve to be paid. But I'd rather not bring no shame, but I'd rather be an example, come on, and work with these hands that I don't hinder the gospel. So I've been like Paul, not because I chose because, first of all, in the ministry, I was dealing with those that have nots. Let me say it again. You got the haves and the have nots. I was dealing with the have nots, and they didn't have, and they were looking at me because God had blessed my life. And so everybody was looking at me as the blessed one. But I was doing things that from 22 years of age that had blessed my life. I tithe. I give. I go to church. I try to raise my family up in the gospel. So that was the seeds that I put in the ground, and God blessed it. So when they saw me, they saw the Reverend in the Jaguar. They saw the Reverend in the Mercedes. But I was a working pastor. I was a working man of God, a brother in the Lord, deal with real estate, deal with loans, deal with investments, property investments. So when they came, I was the one, you know, hey, the reverend, wait a minute. But they didn't contribute to anything. So many times they became trying to milk me. Lord, I'm trying to show him. You teach a man how to fish, and he can learn how to eat for the rest of his life. But they want to eat my fish. Jesus, I look around, everybody standing my fish on the plate. I said, wait a minute. If I give y'all all my fish, I ain't gonna have nothing to eat. Can I say amen? So praise God, amen. Many times, but that's why you have to be a real believer in the Lord. You have to be a real brother or sister, and God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Can I say amen? So praise God. Amen. So there's no pride with me. I'll do whatever God tell me to do, but at the end of the day, I don't want to have to beg anyone for anything, and so far I have not. And I just love him today because he's been faithful. Can I say? Brother, hallelujah. Brother, let me see. They're telling me, amen, that they cannot hear on the phone lines. Praise God. I just got to, yeah. Okay, praise God. Yes, okay, thank you for that text. I do appreciate it. Amen. Yes. Oh, what a mighty God. I guess on the phone lines, they're not taking it in. But amen. But praise God. Hallelujah. So I just want to thank the Lord for what he's done and what he's doing. And again, you know, you can also pull me up on the YouTube. My life is orchestrated by God. I didn't plan to be here, but a brother led me here one Sunday, and I've been here ever since. But I'm led by God. I've been on KPRO for many, many years, Spectrum, many, many years. But at the end of the day, I belong to the Lord. I'm a man of God. He orchestrates my steps. And I wouldn't have it any other way, because, man, sometimes we can make the wrong moves out here. Our family going to regret it. Our family going to pay for it. We're going to pay for it. So it's very important to hear the voice of the Lord. I want to hear the voice of the Lord. Can I say amen? Hallelujah. So, amen. But anyway, let me go back to the word of God. Yeah, I try to get here, and I try to be faithful. I got a busy morning, a busy day, but I give it to the Lord. I give it to the Lord, and I want to show you something. And, you know, many times Jesus goes to the back burner when we feel we're doing all right. But see, how many know I've been there already? I've done that. Meaning I had to learn to conquer my 20s. I had to learn to conquer my 30s. I had to learn to conquer my 40s. I had to learn to conquer I'm still in my 50s. But I had to learn not to let anything blow my mind and stay focused and always hear the voice of the Lord. I'm lost without the Holy Spirit. Can I say amen? He filled me one day getting off work. Yes, I got filled one day. Now, many of you don't understand. Many of you believe there's a Baptist. I was in a Baptist church. Also was an apostolic. I've been through, I got saved in a Baptist, but then I got filled, praise God, and I had to move on. I got filled with his Holy Spirit. Man, the tongues begin to come through. I'm not telling you what nobody told me. I'm telling you what I'm not one to put on. That's why, you know, can I say amen? Okay, thank you. They said the phone line should be okay. Praise the Lord. The phone line should be okay. But let me move. Praise God. I'm not your traditional preacher, because I've been called by God, so it's God's responsibility to take care of his servant, and he has, and I love him with all my heart and soul. When he called, wherever he called, he will provide. But I don't know how he's going to provide, what door he's going to lead me to. I remember buying some property in Arizona, and man, I said, this thing is a burden, and the Lord let me out of it, you know. So we're led by our own, trying to make solid investments down here because we want to have a good living. How many watch American Greed? Well, the thing is, people trying to, some of these people got decent, but they want more. They want more. And really, they're greedy. That's why it's called American greed, because American greedy people. The haves want more and more and more and more. And the have-nots, they expect them to live off nothing. It's the way the world is. It's the way they throw you a food bag every now and then from the food bank. Lord, you don't understand me. Oh, no, Jesus. No, I trust the God who created everything. So let me show you something. I want to go to the Word. And I love him today, and I love him in a special way, because today I do have my home, my lovely wife. I said, Lord, many times as a man of God, I thought I was going to make my family pay for, suffer, because people don't give, people don't tithe. I can count on two fingers, Jesus, those who give. Not at one hand. Yeah, on one hand, maybe, you know, I can count. But guess what? I know a God who provides. I know a God who has blessed, and that's why I love him. It's been that way, but God didn't bring me down that path. You have members that, pastors that have 6,000, 7,000, 10,000 members. I wasn't blessed to have that, but I was saved, and God called me out, and he changed my life. So that part, I thank him, and I love him. I love him with all my heart, with all my soul. Somebody don't understand me. So I'd rather, no matter what I have, I'm going to leave it behind if I don't enjoy it. Now, my prayer is that I enjoy everything you give me, Lord. So I got to continue to do it God's way. Can I say amen? So praise God. I want to show you something. I want to cover as much as I can. Now, I know we're living in a time today. Young people, this generation, the task is, there's another pastor taking over Eddie Long's church, and this pastor Jamal, Dr. Jamal, I forget the man of God's last name, but he's taking over the Eddie Long Baptist church. So praise God, he has a task at hand, but I guess he had built 5,000 or 6,000 there in Baltimore, from what I heard his testimony. And the question they ask him, how are you going to win these young people today? Because people don't want to go to church. They just look at everything on their phones. How are you going to get people that the old folks who held on to the traditional gospel to incorporate with the new people with selfies and iPhones, and they don't want to, you know, it's a different generation today. So how are you going to do it? So, you know, that's his task at hand. But my question is, being a man of God, the word doesn't change. Let me say it again. Actually, the Bible said if we change anything, we take anything, add anything, let the curses that's in this word, that's in his word, come upon you. So the task that I see, how are you going to put something there to make these people compromise with these people? Wait a minute. Now, I can only preach the word. Now, I can preach it softly. I can say, God told me to tell you today, you're going straight to hell unless you turn from your sins, Lord. Or I can tell you, praise God, God told me to tell you, you're going to hell unless you turn from your sins. Now, it doesn't matter how I say it. It's got to still equal the same thing. Come on, somebody. Can I say amen? So, you know, we as ministers, now if we change it, I said, well, I don't know. That's like Carlton Pearson. Now, they say, I don't believe in hell no more. Well, Carl, I thank Carlton Pearson. I thank God I knew the Lord before I heard of you, Mr. Pearson. So guess what? God had changed my life. So that's why no matter who fall, who go back, you got to know God for yourself. And you got to know his word. So then you won't be confused. Now, guess what? If people feel there's no hell, I ain't got to live. No, what he said is you will be burnt up. You will be the last. This earth will be destroyed by fire. The first was water. The last will be fire. That's what he said. Now, whether we burn and burn and burn and burn and burn and never burn up, I don't know, because I ain't God. Jesus, I ain't God. So I don't know how he's going to do that, but I know we still must teach truth. I know he said, man shall die. We are dying every day. Come on, somebody. I know that the word is true, so I'm not here to argue about when you're lady told me, she said, Reverend, you talk to the JWs. JWs is the Jehovah's Witness. I get very close friends that were Jehovah's Witness that were. Some still remain, some are not. But I know Jesus for myself. I'm telling you, there's been no rehab. I smoked cigarettes for at least 7-8 years, just about a pack and a half. 8-9 years, man, and God took all that away. You don't understand me. No rehab, no step three, no two programs and confess it between the organization meetings. The Holy step to Jesus, right? Step to him one time, right? And he'll clean you up. Come on, somebody. Lord. So I don't have time, but I'm here to tell you, if you want to know the risen Christ, surrender all to him, and you will never regret it. you will never regret it. Can I say amen? So I thank him. And I want to run real quickly because time moves so fast. And I said, Lord, he showed me grace. I asked him this morning, show me favor, Lord. Show me favor, Lord. Show me favor, Father God. And he did. I made it here, and I just thank him again. But I say, you can pull me up, Reverend E.C., Reverend E.C. Williams, you should be able to pull me up on YouTube, praise God. NLOD also, you can pull up NLOD, my app is there, NLOD, on the App Store, and something going on with Apple and the company that I'm dealing with. I don't know, app is charging. I said, man, I'm paying out enough money to everybody. Jesus, Lord, everybody got the hand, I want a dollar. Jesus, Lord. So I said, nah, these folks ain't sending nothing in anyway. So praise God, you should be able to pull me up on the App Store, but if not, the web company that I'm dealing with, they have another alternate site. But I said to myself, man, as long as I do what God tells me to do, I'm not going to worry about all this and that. But anyway, you can pull me up, Reverend E.C. Williams, or you can pull me up at New Life Open Doors Church, or you can pull me up at NLOD. Praise God. You can always, and I'm in the media, I try to put it out there. Praise God. I'm here at KCAA. But again, my life is taking another change, another turn, and I'm trying to see which way the Lord is leading me. But one thing for sure is I'm never planning on turning from the living God. And I advise you to get with him, because we don't know how things are going to come about in the last days. We don't know. But you don't want to gamble. You don't want to gamble. Praise God. Now, I'm going to look at Hosea. Let me go to let me go to the book of Amos. Amos. Let me go to Amos. Oh, hallelujah. Can I say amen? You don't hear me? Praise the Lord. How many know can't nobody do you like Jesus? How many know he's worthy of praise? How many know he's worthy? Let me go to Amos chapter 5. And let me bless it. Father, we come in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for what you've done. We do ask for forgiveness of our sins and of our shortcomings. If there's anyone out there under the sound of my voice, there was times I was stuck in the traffic yesterday for 3 hours coming up the hill. Man, I was on the freeway at 6, didn't make it back till 9:30, 3.5 hours. But yet they were saying that a young man tried to commit suicide, and there, you know, he ran into a diesel or something, and the car exploded. The young man died, but the diesel guy was pulled out. But we're in a time today, people is not finding true joy, true love, true hope. So I pray today, if that you out there and you feel like giving up because you're not finding everything you need on social media, you're not finding everything you need in the workplace, you're not finding the love that you need from the family, oh Lord, I pray that you would come, you would ask the Lord right now, Lord Father God, I come in the name of Jesus, pray this prayer with me, I come in the name of Jesus, Lord, Lord, I'm broken, Lord, I'm tired, I'm lost, I'm wretched, Lord, people think I'm one thing, but you know who I am. I'm empty inside. I'm one step from taking my life. I don't know which way to go. I don't know what to do. Lord, set me free, Lord. Lord, I'm not ashamed. If you would take me, if you would have me, right now I confess, Lord, I am a sinner. I confess with my mouth, I am a sinner. In my heart, I believe Jesus came. I believe he's real. I believe he died for the sin of the world. Now I'm asking him to be Lord. Be Lord of my life. Come inside my heart this day, this morning, this hour. I repent, Lord, right now. I don't know what to do. Let me feel you, Lord. Let me feel your presence. If this reverend, what this reverend is saying is true, Lord, let me feel something from you, Lord. Please, Jesus, you're the last opportunity. You're the last hope. I've been told you're the only hope in a lost, dying world. Lord, save the sinner man. Save the sinner woman. Right now, Lord, right now, Lord, right now, Lord, I come in the name of Jesus, and I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, hallelujah. Praise him, praise him. You know, I was coming home one night, amen, I'd been in the city of Pasadena, hanging out with my brothers there, fooling around with this cocaine out there at the time. I thought I had everything under control, but here I'll meet the same old crew tomorrow. Amen. We were freebasing, and you know, the weed I can handle, but I tapped into something, man, that it was controlling. It took your money. It wouldn't let you go home. You woke up ready to do it again, and I found something had taken hold of me that I was not controlling anymore. I needed Jesus for real, and I thank him today that he came inside my life, and he set me free. And I got people that I was with then, they're in jail now. They're damn 20. They've been in there 20 some years, and the devil was trying to kill me too, but because of God, because of God. If you're slinging drugs out there, it won't last. If you're selling dope for that young lady, yes, right now, but she's gonna leave you at the curve. Once you get caught, she's going to the next. She's gonna be like Tammy Baker. You know, when Jim Baker got arrested, she went on to somebody else. Love it. She's, I gotta keep this lifestyle. Lord, now how can I say that? I used to be a supporter of Tammy and Jimmy Baker. I belonged to the club too. I was Dumbo too. I sent my thousand, and my wife did. You know, we wanted to travel and go visit Heritage USA. So I was a part of that. But I also saw Jim Baker handcuffed. And I just moved to Rialto, and he came out of there crying. They had him handcuffed, and it really tripped me out, because this is a man of God. How did this happen? So it really shook me for a minute. And then Tammy, man, I looked at Tammy Baker. She left him to the side, and you know, got with the builder. And so I learned a lot from all this. I'm still a young brother. This is 89, 90. And so I had to still hold on to Jesus. So what I'm telling you is, don't put yourself out there slinging drugs, trying to do anything to get that money. And if you love that man, you'll tell that man get whatever job he can get, and you'll be a family. Don't, ladies, don't force them out there to buy you this fancy lifestyle that you're not going to keep. You're not going to, because it's not reality. You're not going to keep it. So just get somewhere and try to be saved, try to be right, try to live right, and wait on the risen Christ. That's my agenda. That's my agenda. So I always had the task of wanting this, wanting that, but then I always heard the voice of the Lord said, get that house and go sit down and clean the weeds up. I said, okay, Father. I said, you don't understand. I was looking at a house I was going to buy in Victorville, Skylights, and I sold my home in Rialto, a two-year-old home, track house, and I sold it to move into this house in Victorville with the Skylights, the formal dining, beautiful place, Skylights all in the bathroom. This was the thing back then. And it didn't work out for me. I said, man, I was still responsible for the home that I sold in Rialto. I sold it myself, but I was still on that loan, so it didn't work out. So I found another place. Hey, weeds all over the place. I said, man, this ain't no skylight in here, Jesus. I done left the house with dual pane glass, tile roof, and everything to find this place with weeds in the backyard. And I got to get out and clean it up. Jesus, clean the weeds, get to hula hoop, and start scraping. And I said, this don't seem fair, but I didn't argue with the Father. How many know I was in that home for like 10, 11, 12 years? It's been nothing but a blessing. And the Lord allowed me to move out of there, and I'm in another home. But I let God orchestrate my steps. I raised my children, my nephews and nieces. I raised all that got caught up. I raised them in that home. And now God moved me on. And so praise God. And now I look like, you know, everybody, you know, what I really wanted then, I wanted the skylights, the two-story. Now they're so common today. You may be moved next door to Boomer. You paying all this money, and here's Section 8 guy come in, and he paying $40. You say, man, I'm struggling. We can't eat. You know, we can't go nowhere. Us, the dog, the cat, everybody trying to pay this note. Jesus. So, and then here this guy come in Section, this woman come in Section 8, and she right next door to you, and she come in with big baskets of groceries. You peeping out the window. You on a budget. So that's why you have to let God lead you. I wanted to move to Spring Valley Lake. in Victorville. My friend told me, said, if I can't get on that water, I ain't coming up that hill unless I can get on Silver, Spring Valley Lake on that water. I said, all right. I mean, no, he came on. He wasn't on the water. He was in the backyard somewhere further as you move in there, but he wasn't on the water. And he had to get out of there. I don't even think he's not even in town no more. So praise God. You can't try to put on for people. And I had to learn that. I had to learn to go sit down, be faithful, go clean the weeds up, teach my children, and still do what God told me to do. So today, praise God, I'm 56 years old, but I own my home. And the thing is, my wife, who's been faithful to me, she don't have to worry about getting out there punching that clock. And that's the thing, because we're not going to stay here. But if I would have did it any other way, I would have came up short today, and I would regret it. But because I've listened to the voice of God and not my fleshly desires, I had to see these people come through and do this and do that. And I desired it. I love nice areas. I love nice things. But you have to wait and trust God and make what you got nice. Let me move. And I said, let me move. Praise God. Now I'm going to drop down to Amos chapter 5. And I want to look at verse. Let me start at verse 1. Hear this word, Israel the Lamanite. Take up concerning you. Notice what it says. Take up this land concerning you. Fallen is virgin Israel, never to rise again, deserted in her own land with no one to lift her up. This is what the sovereign Lord says to Israel. Your city that marches out 8,000 strong will have only 100 left. See, you can think you're on top. He said, a city that marched out 1,000 strong, you're going to only be left with 100. Notice what he says. Your town that marches out 100 strong will have only 10 left. This is what the Lord says to Israel. Seek me and live. Now I want you to underline the word seek me, verse 5. We're in Amos chapter 5, verse 5. Wait a minute. Seek me and live. Do not seek Bethel. Do not go to Gilgal. Do not journey to Beersheba. For Gilgal will surely go into exile, and Bethel will be reduced to nothing. Verse 6, seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the tribes of Joseph like a fire. Wait a minute, how many know like a fire? You see what's going on in Malibu and all the fires and tragedy that's going on today. See, when he used the word fire, fire is known to consume. It consumes whatever gets in its way. It burn it up. It will burn you up, your possessions, and everything, and turn it bare. Fire represent totally destruction. He says, I will sweep through. Come on, somebody. You don't hear me. Now, let me ask you, who you think you should be serving today? Let me ask you, when he begins to sweep through, who do you think going to rescue you? Oh, come on, somebody. Notice what it says. So verse 6 says, seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the tribes of Joseph like a fire. It would devour them, and Bethel will have no one to quench it. There are those who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. Wait a minute. Justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. People don't want to hear nothing about Jesus today. I asked myself, Lord, well, I belong in the nicest areas that you can think of. I belong in the nicest home, the nicest automobile, but you can't have it all. I remember a good friend, attorney friend of mine, I used to work out at Notless Plus in the city of South Pasadena. And I would meet all type of people. I met dentists there, doctors, and lawyers, attorneys. But they were telling me at the time I was buying my home, he said, you can't have them both. It's a sacrifice. So it's either the car or the home. Well, praise God, if you got that nice car, that car going to take up all your money. If you got that home is going to consume all your money. So you can't have them both. But I had to choose, and I listened to these people because, amen, hallelujah, bless you, brother, bless you. I listened to these people because they were older than me. It's not like today. We don't listen to the older because you can't tell them nothing. They figure you don't know nothing about social media. You don't know nothing about life. You say, well, I didn't get this old just blending around here in the dark. But this generation today, they bring up social media. Do you know about Snapchat? No, I don't know about Snapchat. Do you know about all these different apps? So then the older folks said, no, I don't know them, but I know about life. I know about life, and I know we all got to pass through this thing. We're going to live and we're going to die. Let me say it again. And there's a God in heaven and earth who said it, and it's being fulfilled. So I do know about that. And they'll find out later on when they find themselves in the same situation, when they find themselves have gotten old, when they find themselves they didn't achieve everything, they're going to realize there's a God up in heaven. And man, I didn't win everything. I don't have everything. And actually, I don't even have him now. Then you're going to be in a world of trouble. So what am I saying? You have to learn today. I listened to them, young men. These were, and most of the time, these were Caucasian attorney, and you know, and what I look at us, and we have to change our perception. African Americans, we have to learn to show love, respect to each other, as well as to all God's people. We'll see each other and keep our head turned, won't wave, and just be grinning at the next race. I always had a problem with this. See, I call them. How do you describe them? How do you describe these type of folk? You see all their teeth when it comes to when it comes to other races. And I just got to keep it real. I mean, you know, I got to keep it real because that's who I am. My mother used to tell me, she says, you know, these blacks killing each other off left and right. You said something to them, they ready to slap you. Can I tell you some truth? And I, you know, no, anybody know Reverend, there's no racism here. I got a white daughter-in-law, Hispanic daughter-in-law, Hispanic. Let me see. Do I got an African-American daughter-in-law? I got to think about it. I don't even think I got an African-American daughter-in-law. I don't. So what am I saying? But anyway, this is the thing. You know, this is the thing that my mother told me. She said, one white guy would come in and rule 50. Now, don't see, mama gone on, but she said, we'll kill each other. We look at each other wrong. We'll slap each other. We'll slap the preacher. We'll slap and say, I'll snap your new butthole. We see, we go there behind hole in you. We'll go there to each other. But then we just grinning at everybody else. We just grinning. You see another African American who's doing fairly well. That so and so think he's something. See how we do? But I had a problem with this. I just got to keep it real. Praise God. I got to keep it real. Can I say amen? So anyway, I always had a problem. And I didn't want to be this type of brother. I wanted to love on my own people, love on my whites. I got friends of every race. I'm a man of God. So and basically all the other races have total respect for the Reverend, but the black folk. One sister of mine told me, "Why you think you want to study with the GOP?" I told him, wait a minute now. I done been blessed 35 years in front of y'all. Life changed. Used to smoke weed with you. You seen what God done. Now you going to tell me about the GOP witness. I told him, no, you go study. You go study. You still stumbling all over the place. You still high now. And you'll tell me what to do. I told actually, I don't have no time. Love it. Can I see, that was an insult. What you think I mean? But that's who we are. I didn't bury folks, married folks. I didn't did everything. They didn't see God. And you're going to tell me about go study with, you know, this kind of stuff. That's what comes out of us. You know, I told him, you just go on and study because whatever you've been studying, it ain't working for you. It ain't working for you, dog. Love it. Now let me go back to the Word of God, because I'd be here all day talking about what the way we treat each other and the respect. I'd be here all day. Yeah, ain't enough time. I need at least about 4 or 5 hours, and still not enough time. Somebody may drive down and say, "What does so and so say?" That's who we are. Let me go. Praise God. Now you know, ain't no sense of hating no more. Why I'm talking, I'm keeping it real because I'm not your paid preacher. But these are the things that I seen from a young man. I told you, my brother. I was there maybe 96, 97, and I invited a few churches over, and they were Caucasian, and those are my friends. And one of the brother came, my brother who I used to get high with, his teeth, all his teeth was showing. Everything the preacher was said, I saw his big grin, his big teeth all showing. He just, and I said, wow, now I've been preaching this brother for something like 15 years, and he ain't never made no Jesus. I said, Lord, but I'm just looking. Here, this preacher just, I mean, he wasn't really preaching. He was just, you know, but he, right. I said, Lord. I said, these people saw God take the weed. They saw God take the cocaine. They saw God bless. They saw God do everything, and still no respect. I said, wait a minute. Lord, he just grinning, but he was being phony. Let me say it again. He was being phony. And this preacher eventually turned around and was accused of molesting some children at the church. And the rumor went around. And anyway, he had fallen. Okay, but I'm looking now. Here's brother still standing, 35 years. The preacher's dead now. Not only did the preacher, he turned around and some of the members that came to my church, he wound up going with one of these young girls. I said, now you was old enough to be that girl's daddy. But when you fall into sin, and she had a child by him, she had a baby by him. So all this kind of stuff going on, but that's what you get with the feel-good gospel. This is what you get with the feel-good gospel. You get no change. You get no transformation because you cannot change the word of God. The word is written and it shall stand. It shall stand and God shall confirm his word. You don't understand me. So praise God. Now my brother who was doing all that grinning, he's in jail right now. Praise God. And he's got to be 60 and he's 6 years older than I am. Come on, somebody. Now you're too old to be going to jail. But 60 years old and he'd been given 2 years of prison time, and then I found out he has what is this stuff? TB. What is it? No, he has the stuff they tell you number two. What is? Heard the voice of the Lord. The Lord said, get that house and go sit down and clean the weeds up. I said, okay, Father. I said, you don't understand me. I was looking at a house I was going to buy in Victorville, Skylights, and I sold my home in Rialto, a two-year-old home, track house, and I sold it to buy it to move into this house in Victorville with the Skylights, the formal dining, beautiful place. Skylights all in the bathroom. This was the thing back then. And it didn't work out for me. I said, man, I was still responsible for the home that I sold in Rialto. I sold it myself, but I was still on that loan, so it didn't work out. So I found another place. It had weeds all over the place. I said, man, this ain't no skylight in here, Jesus. I done left the house with dual pane glass, tile roof, and everything to find this place with weeds in the backyard. And I got to get out and clean it up. Jesus said, clean the weeds, get to hula hoop, and start scraping. And I said, this don't seem fair, but I didn't argue with the Father. How many know I was in that home for like 10, 11, 12 years, been nothing but a blessing. And the Lord allowed me to move out of there, and I'm in another home. But I let God orchestrate my steps. I raised my children, my nephews and nieces. I raised all that got caught up. I raised them in that home. And now God moved me on. And so praise God. And now I look like, you know, everybody, you know, what I really wanted then, I wanted the skylights, the two-story. Now they're so common today. You may be moved next door to Boomer. You paying all this money, and here's Section 8 guy come in, and he paying $40. You say, man, I'm struggling. We can't eat. You know, we can't go nowhere. Us, the dog, the cat, everybody trying to pay this note. Jesus. So, and then here this guy come in Section, this woman come in Section 8, and she right next door to you, and she come in with big baskets of groceries. You peeping out the window. You on a budget. So that's why you have to let God lead you. I wanted to move to Spring Valley Lake in Victorville. My friend told me, said, if I can't get on that water, I ain't coming up that hill unless I can get on Silver, you know, Spring Valley Lake on that water. I said, all right. I mean, no, he came on. He wasn't on the water. He was in the backyard somewhere further as you move in there, but he wasn't on the water. And he had to get out of there. I don't even think he's not even in town no more. So praise God. You can't try to put on for people. And I had to learn that. I had to learn to go sit down, be faithful, go clean the weeds up, teach my children, and still do what God told me to do. So today, praise God, I'm 56 years old, but I own my home. And the thing is, my wife, who's been faithful to me, she don't have to worry about getting out there punching that clock. And that's the thing, because we're not going to stay here. But if I would have did it any other way, I would have came up short today, and I would regret it. But because I've listened to the voice of God and not my fleshly desires, I had to see these people come through and do this and do that. And I desired it. I love nice areas. I love nice things. But you have to wait and trust God and make what you got nice. Let me move. You know what I'm saying? I said, let me move. Praise God. Now I'm going to drop down to Amos chapter 5. And I want to look at verse. Let me start at verse 1. Hear this word, Israel the Lamet. Take up concerning you. Notice what it says. Take up this lament concerning you. Fallen is virgin Israel, never to rise again, deserted in her own land with no one to lift her up. This is what the sovereign Lord says to Israel. Your city, that marches out 8,000 strong will have only 100 left. See, you can think you're on top. He said, a city that marched out 1,000 strong, you're going to only be left with 100. Notice what he says. Your town that marches out 100 strong will have only 10 left. This is what the Lord says to Israel. Seek me and live. Now, I want you to underline the word seek me, verse 5. We're in Amos chapter 5, verse 5. Wait a minute. Seek me and live. Do not seek Bethel. Do not go to Gilgal. Do not journey to Beersheba. For Gilgal will surely go into exile, and Bethel will be reduced to nothing. Verse 6, seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the tribes of Joseph like a fire. Wait a minute, how many know like a fire? You see what's going on in Malibu and all the fires and tragedy that's going on today. See, when he used the word fire, fire is known to consume. It consumes whatever gets in its way. It burn it up. It will burn you up, your possessions, and everything, and turn it bare. Fire represent totally destruction. He says, I will sweep through. Come on, somebody. You don't hear me. You don't hear me. Now, let me ask you, who you think you should be serving today? Let me ask you, when he begins to sweep through, who do you think going to rescue you? Oh, come on, somebody. Notice what it says. So verse 6 says, seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the tribes of Joseph like a fire. It will devour them, and Bethel will have no one to quench it. There are those who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. Wait a minute. Justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. People don't want to hear nothing about Jesus today. You know, again, I asked myself, Lord, well, I belong in the nicest areas that you can think of. I belong in the nicest home, the nicest automobile, but you can't have it all. I remember a good friend, attorney friend of mine. I used to work out at Nautilus Plus in the city of South Pasadena. And I would meet all type of people. I met dentists there, doctors, and lawyers, attorneys. But they were telling me at the time I was buying my home, he said, you can't have them both. It's a sacrifice. So it's either the car or the home. Well, praise God, you know, if you got that nice car, that car going to take up all your money. If you got that home is going to consume all your money. So you can't have them both. But I had to choose, and I listened to these people because, amen, hallelujah, bless you, brother, bless you. I listened to these people because they were older than me. It's not like today. We don't listen to the older because you can't tell them nothing. They figure you don't know nothing about social media. You don't know nothing about life. You say, well, I didn't get this old just blending around here in the dark. But this generation today, they bring up social media. Do you know about Snapchat? No, I don't know about Snapchat. Do you know about all these different apps? So then the older folks said, no, I don't know them, but I know about life. I know about life, and I know we all got to pass through this thing. We're going to live and we're going to die. Let me say it again. And there's a God in heaven and earth who said it, and it's being fulfilled. So I do know about that. And they'll find out later on when they find themselves in the same situation, when they find themselves have gotten old, when they find themselves they didn't achieve everything, they don't realize there's a God up in heaven. And man, I didn't win everything. I don't have everything. And actually, I don't even have him now. Then you're going to be in a world of trouble. So what am I saying? You have to learn today. I listened to them, young men. These were, and most of the time, these were Caucasian attorney. And, you know, and when I look at us, and we have to change our perception, African-Americans. We have to learn to show love, respect to each other, as well as to all God's people. We'll see each other and keep our head turned, won't wave, and just be grinning at the next race. I always had a problem with this. See, I call them, how do you describe them? How do you describe these type of folk? You see all their teeth when it comes to when it comes to other races. And I just got to keep it real. I got to keep it real because that's who I am. My mother used to tell me, she says, you know, these blacks killing each other off left and right. You said something to them, they ready to slap you. Can I tell you some truth? And I, you know, no, anybody know Reverend, there's no racism here. I got a white daughter-in-law, Hispanic daughter-in-law, Hispanic. Let me see. Do I got an African-American daughter-in-law? I got to think about it. I don't even think I got an African-American daughter-in-law. I don't. So what am I saying? But anyway, this is the thing, this is the thing that my mother told me. She said, one white guy will come in and rule 50. Now, don't see, mama gone on, but she said, we'll kill each other. We look at each other wrong. We'll slap each other. We'll slap the preacher. We'll slap and say, I'll snap your new butthole. We see, we go there behind hole in you. We'll go there to each other, but then we just grinning at everybody else. We just grinning. You see another African-American who's doing fairly well. That so-and-so think he's something. See how we do? But I had a problem with this. I just got to keep it real. Praise God. I got to keep it real. Can I say amen? So anyway, I always had a problem. And I didn't want to be this type of brother. I wanted to love on my own people, love on my whites. I got friends of every race. I'm a man of God. So and basically all the other races have total respect for the Reverend, but the black folk. One sister of mine told me, well, you think you want to study with the GOP? I told her, wait a minute now. I done been blessed 35 years in front of y'all. Life changed. Used to smoke weed with you. You seen what God done. Now you going to tell me about the GOP witness. I told her, no, you go study. You go study. You still stumbling all over the place. You still high now. And you'll tell me what to do. I told her, actually, I don't have no time. Love it. See, that was an insult. What you think I mean? But that's who we are. I didn't bury folks, married folks. I didn't did everything. They didn't see God. And you're going to tell me about go study with, this kind of stuff. That's what comes out of us. You know, I told him, you just go on and study, because whatever you've been studying, it ain't working for you. It ain't working for you, dog. Love it. Now let me go back to the Word of God, because I'd be here all day talking about the way we treat each other and the respect. I'd be here all day. Yeah, enough time. I need at least about 4 or 5 hours, and still not enough time. Somebody may drive down and say, what does so and so say? That's who we are. Let me go. Praise God. Now, ain't no sense of hate no more. Why I'm talking, I'm keeping it real, because I'm not your paid preacher. But these are the things that I seen from a young man. I told you, my brother, I was there in 90, maybe 96, 7. And I invited a few churches over, and they were Caucasian, and those are my friends. And one of the brother came, my brother, who I used to get high with, his teeth, all his teeth was showing. Everything the preacher was saying, I saw his big grin, his big teeth all showing. He just, and I said, wow, now I've been preaching this brother for something like 15 years, and he ain't never made no Jesus. I said, Lord, but I'm just looking. Here, this preacher just, I mean, he wasn't really preaching. He was just, but he, I said, Lord. I said, these people saw God take the weed. They saw God take the cocaine. They saw God bless. They saw God do everything, and still no respect. I said, wait a minute. Lord, he just grinning, but he was being phony. Let me say it again. He was being phony. And this preacher eventually turned around and was accused of molesting some children at the church. And the rumor went around. And anyway, he had fallen. Okay, but I'm looking now. Here's brother still standing 35 years. The preacher's dead now. Not only did the preacher, he turned around and some of the members that came to my church, he wound up going with one of these young girls. I said, now you was old enough to be that girl's daddy. But when you fall into sin, and she had a child by him, she had a baby by him. So all this kind of stuff going on. But that's what you get with the feel-good gospel. This is what you get with the feel-good gospel. You get no change. You get no transformation, because you cannot change the Word of God. The Word is written, and it shall stand. It shall stand, and God shall confirm his Word. You don't understand me. So praise God. Now, my brother who was doing all that grinning, he's in jail right now. Praise God. And he's got to be 60, and he's 6 years older than I am. Come on, somebody. Now, you're too old to be going to jail. But 60 years old, and he'd been given 2 years of prison time. And then I found out he has, what is this stuff? TB. What is it? No, he has the stuff they tell you, number two. What is it called? Diabetes 2? Not diabetes 2. When your kidneys and all this stuff, maybe it is diabetes. Yeah, but stuff you get for shooting up. What is that? Drug, okay, you say I'm lost on that one. I'm lost, okay. Okay, hepatitis. There you go, type 2. Now I just found out, and it's sad, because, my beloved mother told me, she says, I feel Terry, which is my brother, is going to suffer when I'm dead and gone. And now look, mama's gone, and and my brother's suffering now.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
Your NBC Sports Radio update starts now.
What a football Sunday. I'm Jeff Biggs, and first we start with the big news in college football. The final playoff rankings have been released. Alabama, Clemson, Notre Dame, and